Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Chaitali Parekh, consultant musculoskeletal interventional radiologist practicing at Pulse Chain of Diagnostic Centers and New Tech Diagnostic Center in Mumbai. Today we are going to begin with a complete session on knee meniscal MRI imaging, and which is actually divided into three sessions or three videos. Today's session is particularly on the meniscal anatomy, followed by normal variants and what normal structures can mimic a tear. Now this is important because when we label a meniscal signal as a tear, there are likely chances that the patient may land up with an arthroscopic surgery. So we need to be really sure before labeling something as a tear. And for this, it is important to know the normal structures which can mimic a tear. So that is what we'll be discussing in today's session. The next session is on the meniscal tears. What are the types of meniscal tears? And what are the important points that you need to mention in a report so that the orthopod can take a further decision on the line of management? And the third session is a difficult one, which is on the post-operative meniscus. Now, this is a topic with multiple gray zones. So we'll be predominantly discussing on when to call a meniscal signal as a post-operative signal and when to label it as a re-tear, which is actually very important from the management point of view. So in order to understand the menisci in detail, please stay tuned for today's session as well as the videos which are going to come in very soon. Thank you so much. Today we'll be discussing about meniscal variants, that is when not to call a meniscal tear. In today's session, we won't be concentrating on the sequences, and as far as the anatomy goes, we'll only be discussing about the meniscal anatomy. For all those who are interested in knowing the sequences and MRI knee joint anatomy in detail, you can go back to the MRI knee joint anatomy video, which is there on the Indian Radiologist YouTube channel. After that, we'll be discussing about normal structures that look like a tear, that is tear mimics. And finally, we'll look at the normal meniscal variants. As far as the meniscal anatomy goes, all of us know that there are two menisci in the knee joint, the medial and the lateral. Both the menisci have got five parts. So you have an anterior root and a posterior root. Then there is an anterior horn and a posterior horn. And finally, there is a longer structure, which is nothing but the central part of the meniscus, which is the body of the meniscus. Now, if you'll imagine, or if you'll just think about it, whenever you look at the axial cuts of an MRI knee, and if luckily you have a section that's going through the menisci, the menisci will have an appearance like this. So this is exactly when you're looking at the meniscus from above. Now, whenever you want to take sagittal images, the first image that you'll cut, so this is through the periphery of the meniscus or the periphery of the medial or the lateral compartment, whichever you're concentrating on. And whenever you cut through this particular plane on a sagittal image, you'll see the meniscus in the form of a box or a rectangle. Next, when you come further towards the midline in the joint, you get a bow tie appearance of the meniscus, which is when you are cutting through this section of the body. And finally, when you come further more towards the midline, what you can see is two triangular structures, and these are nothing but your anterior and the posterior horn. So if you'll see, this is your anterior horn and this is your posterior horn, and there is nothing in between. So this is what is the appearance of both medial and lateral meniscus on a sagittal image. So this is the MRI knee sagittal image to show you how it looks like. So this is the most peripheral section where you see the meniscus in the form of a rectangle. Then you begin to see a bow tie appearance of the meniscus, which is nothing but the body again. And finally, you see two triangular structures, which is nothing but your anterior horn and posterior horn. Now on coronal images, so why on coronal images it is important to look at the body, because as you've seen on the sagittal images, We could see the body in the form of a rectangle or a bow tie. But when you want to see the body in the form of a triangle, that will be seen on a coronal image. So here you can see that whenever you are cutting on the coronal image, this particular section of the body, you will see the body in the form of a triangle. So this is what is the appearance of the body on a coronal image. So the triangular appearance for the anterior and posterior horn is on a sagittal image, whereas for the body it is on the coronal image. Now let us just know more about the medial and lateral menisci and the differences between the two. So the medial meniscus has an open C-shaped or a semicircular appearance. An important point to note is that the posterior horn of the medial meniscus is larger than the anterior horn. So it's nearly double the size of the anterior horn. Now why this is important? Whenever there is a meniscal tear and there is a displaced meniscal flap in the posterior horn, you will find that the posterior horn is attenuated or smaller in size. And if the posterior horn appears of the same size of anterior horn, you know that there is a tear in the posterior horn, because the posterior horn of the medial meniscus has to be nearly double the size of the anterior horn. And the third point is that it is less mobile because it is attached to the deep fibers of medial collateral ligament. And because it is less mobile, medial meniscus is more prone to tears. Similarly, lateral meniscus has a tight C-shaped appearance. So you can see it is more C-shaped, while this is an open C-shaped thing. So this is more like an incomplete circular appearance. Now again, an important point to note is that the posterior horn and anterior horn, they are similar in size. So whenever on a sagittal image, if you will compare the anterior horn and the posterior horn, you will find that both of them are same in size for a lateral meniscus. But again, remember, for a medial meniscus, the posterior horn is double the size of the anterior horn on the sagittal image. So in case of a lateral meniscus, if you find that the posterior horn is smaller as compared to the anterior horn, you know that there is a tear in the posterior horn. And the lateral meniscus is loosely attached to the joint capsule. That is because between the meniscus and the joint capsule, you have a popliteal hiatus through which your popliteus tendon passes and goes out of the joint. So as we all know, the popliteus tendon is an intra-articular structure, and then it passes through the capsule and goes out. So therefore, it is loosely attached to the joint capsule. Now, MRI anatomy of the menisci. So again, we are looking at the sagittal image, and first we'll be looking on the medial meniscus. So this is nothing but your medial compartment. Medial femorotibial compartment, and what we'll be doing is we'll be going from periphery towards the midline. So the structure that you see over here, this black structure, that is nothing but your medial collateral ligament. Now as you go further towards the midline, you begin to see a jet black structure, right? So this bone is your femur. One section inside, you begin to see the tibia as well. And between the femur and the tibia, you see this jet black structure, and this is nothing but your medial meniscus. So initially, it has a more of a rectangular appearance, okay, which is nothing but the body. And then as you go further inside, you begin to see two structures. So this is one triangular structure and this is another triangular structure. And these are nothing but your anterior and posterior horns. And as I have stressed upon even before, the posterior horn of medial meniscus is double the size of the anterior horn. So this is how a normal medial meniscus will look on a sagittal image. If you find that the posterior horn and anterior horn are similar in size, you have to think about a posterior horn tear and look for a displaced meniscal flap. As we go further towards the midline, we begin to see the anterior root and the posterior root attachment of the medial meniscus. Now, same thing we'll be doing for the lateral femorotibial compartment. So we are going from periphery to the midline on a sagittal PD image. And as you go, so first structure that you see over here, this is nothing but your fibular collateral ligament and biceps tendon. So this is a conjoint tendon which will go and attach to the fibular head. Now as you go further towards the midline, you begin to see the lateral femur and the lateral tibia. And again, a rectangular shaped meniscus between them, which is nothing but your lateral meniscus. As you go further inside, you begin to see the classic bow tie appearance. Okay. And this is again nothing but the body of the lateral meniscus. And further medially, you begin to see two triangular structures, which is your anterior horn and posterior horn. And now if you'll have a look closely, the anterior and the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus are similar in size. So this is a point to remember. And further towards the midline, you begin to see the anterior root and the posterior root of the medial meniscus. And just one more point to remember is, normally the anterior root attachment of the lateral meniscus has a striated appearance. So here if you see, there are striations in it and it has a slight hyperintense signal. So there is intrinsic hyperintense signal within the anterior root attachment of the lateral meniscus, and that is normal. So you should not label this as a degeneration or a tear. So remember, the anterior root attachment of lateral meniscus has a normal striated appearance with hyperintense signal within. Now let us look at tear mimics, that is normal structures that look like a tear but they are not a tear. Okay, so as you can see, this is your lateral meniscus because your anterior horn and posterior horn are similar in size. While we're just playing this video, I need you to concentrate on this tiny black structure. Okay, I've already labeled it. If you see closely on this still image, you'll feel that there is a tear. So there is a tear between this lateral meniscus and this superior margin of the lateral meniscus anterior horn. Now let us look at on the entire sequences. So if you will see this tiny jet black structure, okay, this structure which will go and attach to the anterior horn of medial meniscus. Now again we are coming back, and this is the jet black structure which is coming and attaching to the anterior horn of lateral meniscus. Okay, I'll again play this video for you. So you can see this jet black structure, it's going and attaching to the anterior horn of medial meniscus. Again, we'll be coming back. Yeah, so here you feel that there is a tear, but it's coming and attaching to the anterior horn of lateral meniscus as well. So this is nothing but your transverse meniscal ligament. So this is a ligament that attaches the anterior horn of lateral meniscus to the anterior horn of medial meniscus. Whenever you look only on a sagittal image and on a still section or one particular image, you'll see that at the point where it goes and attaches to the medial meniscus or the lateral meniscus, it looks like a tear, but it is not a tear. Okay, so just trace the entire sequence and you'll understand that it's not a tear along the superior margin of the meniscus, but instead it is a transverse meniscal ligament. Okay. Now again, we are looking at the lateral femorotibial compartment. Your anterior horn and posterior horn are similar in size. So as you go towards the midline, here you can see that at the superior border of the posterior horn of lateral meniscus, there is a thin jet black structure. Now if I give you this one single image, you'll feel that there is a tear. There is a tear which is reaching up to the superior margin of posterior horn of lateral meniscus. Now as you go further towards the midline, you'll find that you can still appreciate this gap. Okay, further again, here again you can appreciate the gap, and this is the black structure. This is the black structure. You can again appreciate here, it looks like completely like a longitudinal tear in the periphery of the posterior horn of lateral meniscus. And further on, what you see is that this structure, and plus there is another black structure. So this linear black jet black structure, this particular structure is nothing but your posterior cruciate ligament, and there is a jet black structure which appears like a dot which is posterior to the posterior cruciate ligament, and then there is one dot that is anterior to the posterior cruciate ligament. Now these are nothing but your meniscofemoral ligaments. The anterior one is ligament of Humphrey and the posterior one is ligament of Risberg. Now how do you remember? Just remember that in alphabetical order, H comes before, so H is anterior. So the first thing or the most anterior one is the first in the alphabetical order, and W comes later, so W is posterior. So this is how you remember the names. Obviously, it is not much important to remember ligament of Humphrey, but you need to remember ligament of Risberg. I'll tell you in a while why it is important. And as the name suggests, it is nothing but a meniscofemoral ligament. So it is a ligament that connects the meniscal or the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus to the femur. So again, we'll go back. Sorry. Okay. So here you can see that it looks like a tear. But when you completely trace the image, you'll find that it is nothing but the meniscofemoral ligament. Now, I told you to specifically remember ligament of Risberg. And that is important because in anterior cruciate ligament injuries, you get a posterior horn lateral meniscal tear, which is called as the Risberg rip tear. Now, normally, what happens is, this hyperintense linear signal that you see in the posterior horn of lateral meniscus, it is only restricted up to the medial most one third or half of the posterior horn. So, if this is your lateral meniscus, okay, this is your anterior root and this is your posterior root and this is your intercondylar notch. It's fine. So, this is the midline, which is the intercondylar notch, and this is your peripheral part. So, whenever there is a ligament of Risberg, whenever you see this on a sagittal image and you'll correlate it on the axial images, you'll find that the hyperintense signal is restricted like this. So, this is your hyperintense signal here, okay, and this hyperintense signal is present only up to the medial one third or half of the posterior horn of lateral meniscus. But instead, if this hyperintense signal is extending up to the posterior horn body junction or in the peripheral one third of the lateral meniscus, so this entire thing is looking like this, okay? So if this entire thing is having a hyperintense signal, then you call it as a Risberg rip tear. And to further understand the Risberg rip tear, we'll be discussing it in further videos when we come down to the meniscal tears. So just remember, normally, your hyperintense signal between the posterior horn and the Risberg ligament is only restricted up to the medial one third or half of the posterior horn of lateral meniscus. When this signal extends further towards the periphery, that is nothing but your Risberg rip tear. And another thing, do not overcall Risberg rip tear. It only happens when there is a anterior cruciate ligament injury. Okay. Now, the next thing what you need to see is here. So, there are two things if you'll closely watch. First thing I want you to look at is there is a black structure here. This is your medial femoral tibial compartment. On the lateral side, you don't see a significant black structure. So, all you see is some thin hypointense strands. So, this medial black structure in the intercondylar notch is your posterior cruciate ligament. So, this is your PCL, okay? And here what you don't see a significant black structure but just few thin strands, this is actually the location of an ACL. But in this particular patient, there has been an ACL tear and there is no healthy ACL remnant. So, these are the two normal structures that you see in an intercondylar notch. Now, if you look, you are able to see two more structures over here. So, there is one jet black structure which is a small one, this. And there is another jet black structure, okay? Now, there are two different structures. So, there are in total four structures in the intercondylar notch. Now, again, we'll come from anterior to front to back, that is anterior to posterior. This is the lateral compartment. This is your anterior horn of the lateral meniscus. Now, as you go posteriorly, okay, you see that this structure is actually arising from the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus. Further on, you'll see that this structure is actually coming from the body. So, this is nothing but the bucket handle tear of the lateral meniscus. And if you'll see that this structure is the displaced meniscal flap in the intercondylar notch. And if you'll closely look, even the body is blunted. So, normally a body should have a triangular appearance, right? So, this is how we've discussed that on a coronal image, the body will have a triangular appearance. But here you'll see the body has a more of a blunted appearance, right? And so, this blunting is because this particular meniscal flap has displaced in the intercondylar notch. Further on, as you go posteriorly, you'll see that this flap goes and attaches to the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. So, again, we'll come from posterior to anterior now. This is your posterior horn, and if you closely look in this region, you'll see a flap is arising from there, going in the intercondylar notch and coming and attaching to the anterior horn and anterior root of the lateral meniscus. So this is surely a bucket handle tear of the lateral meniscus. Now what is the second structure? So again, if you'll see, the second structure is arising from here, which is nothing but the anterior root of medial meniscus, right? So this is your structure, okay? Now as you go further posteriorly, this is the structure. This one, again, this is the structure. This is the structure. It goes and attaches to the posterior root of lateral meniscus, okay? So again, we'll come back. So it's arising from I'll just get it completely anteriorly. Okay, so again, it's arising from the anterior root of medial meniscus and goes posteriorly and attaches to the, so this is your structure, attaches to the posterior root of lateral meniscus. So now what are these both structures? So this structure which we saw is arising from the anterior horn of lateral meniscus and going to the posterior horn of lateral meniscus, that is your bucket handle tear. And this another structure is a normal structure within the joint. It is not always visible, but when visible, it can cause confusion with bucket handle tear. And this is nothing but oblique menisco-meniscal ligament. So it arises from the anterior horn or the anterior root of medial meniscus, goes and attaches to the posterior horn or posterior root of lateral meniscus. So if you see a extra structure in the intercondylar notch, which is attaching to the anterior and posterior horn of the same menisci, that is your bucket handle tear. If you see a structure that is arising from one meniscus and going to another meniscus, that is your oblique menisco-meniscal ligament. So just remember this and it will be sorted. So this over here, if you see, this is your oblique menisco-meniscal ligament, which is arising from one meniscus and going to another meniscus. Now the third structure, which is normal but can look like a tear, are the popliteal meniscal fascicles. So here you will feel that there is some tear between the periphery and this thing. So this is nothing but the popliteal meniscal fascicle. So there are about three popliteal meniscal fascicles. You do not need to know the name of each of it, but just remember that they are thin linear hypointense bands which connect the posterior horn of lateral meniscus to the popliteal tendon sheath. So, and there is normal fluid signal over here. So this again should not be mistaken for a tear. Important is to remember that with cruciate ligament injuries, there can be injury to the popliteal meniscal fascicle and you need to report them. So you need to report them as a popliteal meniscal fascicular injury or a posterolateral capsular injury, whatever wordings you want to use, but it should be reported. Now we've looked at those structures which are normally present in the knee joint but look like a tear. Now we'll be looking at normal variants. Okay, so these are meniscal variants which are seen in asymptomatic individuals and they do not indicate tear. So the first is a discoid meniscus, and there are three types of discoid meniscus: a complete discoid, incomplete discoid, or a Risberg variant. Second is meniscal flounce, and then we look at meniscal ossicle. Now this is your normal, so first thing you know to know is discoid meniscus is more common on the lateral side than on the medial side. So this is your normal lateral meniscus, which is the body. If you will see on a coronal section, the body has a clean triangular appearance. Now here also the body has a proper triangular appearance, but it is longer. Okay, so here this is your partial discoid and this is your complete discoid. So if your meniscus, the lateral meniscus, is extending towards the midline, so this is your entire body, and if it is involved, if it is extending more than 80% of the tibial articular surface, so this is your 80% and this is the rest 20%. So if it is involving more than 80% of the tibial articular surface, that is when you call it as a complete discoid. If it is involving less than 80% of the tibial articular surface, that is when you call it as a partial discoid. Now the important thing is when to call it a discoid in the first place. So it is very easy to diagnose complete discoid. There is always a confusion with partial discoid. Do not overcall partial discoid or incomplete discoid meniscus. Remember, whenever first thing is obviously on eyeballing. So you can just open any other normal knee joint and look at a normal body. and then you can just take a call. So eyeballing is what we usually use. If it is too much dicey, you can go by a criteria, which is that the discoid meniscus, the for a discoid meniscus on the coronal section, if the body is more than 15 millimeters. But using an exact mathematical criteria is not ideal because it can vary depending upon the build of the person. So the second, which is more viable way of diagnosing a discoid meniscus, is absent bow tie sign. So now, as we have seen that normally, as you go towards the midline, the body takes a bow tie appearance. Now, if this bow tie appearance is not seen for three consecutive sections, okay? So if you'll see that the body is in the form of a rectangle for three consecutive sections, that is when you call it as a discoid meniscus. Now, again, this criteria has some particular rules before you follow it. So it is when you are using a approximately 3 millimeter thickness section with a zero slice gap. So if you're using a 5 millimeter thickness section, then obviously you will never identify a partial discoid meniscus because it won't be that much longer, because the difference between the two slices is 5 millimeters. So the criteria is when the difference between the two slices is 3 millimeter, which is the routine protocol that we use in any knee joint MRI. So 3 millimeter slice thickness with a zero slice gap. Now, here if you'll see, this is the first section and you can see the rectangular appearance of the body of the meniscus. Again, second section, you should see the rectangular body. Now, on the third section, I should get a bow tie appearance. But still, I'm not getting a bow tie appearance in this patient. It is still pretty much rectangular. Still, it is rectangular. Now, it is somewhat begin to develop a bow tie appearance. So, if you'll see, there is a curve that is begin to appear. So it is somewhat started with a bow tie appearance. Now you can still see, okay. And by now, actually, you should be seeing the anterior and the posterior horn separately. There shouldn't be an attachment between the two, but still you can see that there is a meniscal tissue which is connecting the anterior and the posterior horns. So, and now you can appreciate the bow tie as well. So this is what is nothing but a discoid meniscus. So you are not able to see the bow tie on the third sequence or the third image. And if you find that you've pretty much gone towards the midline, but still the anterior and the posterior horn are connected by the meniscal tissue. So that was a discoid lateral meniscus. Now this is a second second normal variant, which is nothing but the Risberg variant of discoid meniscus. So if you remember, I had told you that in a normal individual, you'll see popliteal meniscal fascicles here, right? So this is your posterior horn of lateral meniscus. This is your popliteus tendon, okay? So this is going to be your capsule and the popliteus tendon sheath. So between these two, what you'll see is the popliteal meniscal fascicles. Now, whenever you don't see any fascicle, and you see more than that, more important is if you see a clear fluid-filled gap in this region. This is nothing but the Risberg variant. So if the person does not have a history of trauma, you shouldn't label this as a tear. Okay. If the person has intact cruciate ligaments and everything, do not label this as a tear. But instead, this is nothing but the Risberg variant of the discoid meniscus. So you can put it as Risberg variant of discoid meniscus with lack of visualization of popliteal meniscal fascicles. And these patients will classically have a clinical history of snapping knee. So whenever you get this history and you see this finding, please report it. Okay. Now the next meniscal variant is the meniscal flounce. Now what is a meniscal flounce? It is nothing but this wavy appearance of the free margin. So if you see, this is your apical free margin or the apex of the meniscus, right? Which is a triangular shaped meniscus. Now, if you'll see here, there is a wavy appearance of the apex of the meniscus. And this is normal. This should not be labeled as a tear. This is nothing but a meniscal flounce. It does not have any much clinical significance. But the important thing to remember is not to label it as a tear. And the last meniscal variant that we're going to discuss is meniscal ossicle. Now, meniscal ossicle is ossification that usually happens towards the posterior root attachment of the meniscus, more oftenly involving medial meniscus. And with the why does it happen? There is no particular theory, but there are a couple of theories that it could be secondary to trauma or degeneration. The important is not the cause. again, it is not clinically significant. You do not have to operate this patient, and that is where the importance lies. Now, if we look on the proton density image, it appears hyperintense. It is within the substance of the meniscus. Do not label this as a degeneration or a tear of the meniscus. How to differentiate it? Always look at the fat saturated image. Since this is a bone or an ossification, you will find that it will completely suppress on a fat saturated image. Second, look at the X-ray. You will see it on a lateral view of the X-ray. Third, if you have a CT cut, you can look at the calcification or the ossification in this region. So remember, meniscal ossicle will be nearly the shape of the meniscus within the substance of the meniscus, but do not label it as a tear because it does not require any intervention, any surgical intervention. And how to identify it? Look at your fat saturated image, look at the X-ray, and look at the CT if you have. Do not get a CT cut done for this person for this purpose. Look at the X-ray first. But if you are still in doubt, then maybe you can go for it. So just to sum up, things which are not to be mistaken for a tear: transverse meniscal ligament, remember they connect the two anterior horns of the menisci. Meniscofemoral ligaments, which is ligament of Humphrey and Risberg. Risberg is important. You have to differentiate the normal ligament from Risberg rib tear. Oblique menisco-meniscal ligament, this is very important. If it is seen, it can create a confusion with bucket handle tear. So look at it carefully. Popliteal meniscal fascicles, identify them in case of cruciate ligament injuries. Look at them because you need to report popliteal meniscal fascicular injury or posterior lateral capsular injury. Meniscal flounce, do not label it as a tear. And meniscal ossicle, please use other modalities like radiographs to differentiate it from a tear.
I hope you've liked today's session, and now I'm sure that none of you is going to label a normal structure as a meniscal tear. If you've really liked today's session, please hit the like button, and you can put in your comments in the comment section. And if any of you have any queries regarding the topic, please feel free to ask them in the comment section and I'll revert back to you. And please stay tuned for the next videos to come in on the meniscal tear and postoperative meniscus. Thank you.